John, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here with you today. I've been looking forward to it.
Well, it's great to have you. And on today's show, we're talking about leadership, but we're talking more about internal leadership. Of course, your book is talking about external leadership, how to lead others. And first of all, I want to tell you that I loved your book. To me, the stories of your growth from the ground level up through Primerica and all the challenges that you had throughout that period really drove home each of your leadership points in a way that made the book, in my opinion, very hard to put down. I could see where real leadership can be used by organizations that give copies to their staff in order to help build a culture that breeds influencers and leaders. But tell me, at the beginning of the financial crisis in 2008, financial giants like Bear Stearns, Lehman Brothers were falling. Primerica seemed sheltered by its parent, Citigroup. Of course, Citigroup was having their own problems.
And
that's right, exactly. And they eventually kind of threw it to the wolves and spun off Primerica in an IPO. Right. And from that IPO, it's also my understanding that Primerica received no operating capital. So as the head of Primerica, you were suddenly left on your own in the middle of a financial storm, expected to compete with the likes of MetLife, Pru, and others. My question is about focus. How does somebody in that position meet the challenge of staying focused when you're being bombarded with nothing but negative news?
You know, it's actually a very interesting process, and just a slight adjustment to that. We, our business had been a part of Citi for 20 years, and we were very successful. Our business was very profitable, and in fact had significant excess capital on our books. We were $4 billion of excess capital on our books. So as we were trying to separate, and in truth, it was Rick, my business partner, Rick Williams, and I were co-CEOs. We were the ones that drove wanting to separate from Citi, because a city being under TARP, all of the issues, it had become a very toxic environment for our business. And so our biggest challenge was to make sure that Citi, which was capital depleted, we were capital rich, that we could make the transaction work in a way where it worked for Citi. So, well, I'm not going to get into all the details, but we did a very kind of complex reinsurance transaction that Rick was really the genius of, that left Citi with the book of life insurance business that we had a service contract for. We left as a smaller business, but with a great growth trajectory. Mm-hmm. So it was really a transaction that actually worked for both sides. But to your question, in the height of the collapse, most of the people in our home office, in our sales force, their entire net worth had been Citigroup stock. And if you remember, it went from, $50 a share down to below a dollar.
I remember all too well, yes.
I've got the scars and the lost carry forwards to prove it. Mm. And it was incredibly turbulent. And as we were dealing with that, I remember having many arguments with Citi where I said, look, I'm trying to get my people on an ark and get them to a safe harbor so that they're safe, so that they're at a place that works for them. The focus that kept me going was I knew I was responsible for my people's lives. See, I was with the company 30 years, 33 years in total. We had 300 employees of our 2,000 that had been with the company for over 30 years. And our sales force all over the US and Canada, many of them with the company over 20 years, they weren't my employees, they were my friends. And I knew I was fighting for families' lives. Mm-hmm. And when you have that focus, when it's bigger than a balance sheet, when it's bigger than a check, when it's an existential fight for people's lives that you love, that keeps you focused. I mean, it really does.
That's a great answer. I know also in your book, you talk about lighting the fire within people versus lighting the fire under people. Can you talk to that for just a moment?
Absolutely.
I thought it was great language.
Well, I appreciate that very much because it's something I believe strongly. You know, bosses, which is double S-O-B spelled backwards, light a fire under people. You know, fear motivates in the short term. If you're afraid you're going to get fired, guess what? You'll work hard for a few days. But what lasts for the long term is when you light a fire within people, in their soul, in their heart, and you get them to perform, being a part of the team. See, I believe great leaders, real leaders, are not people that yell at people, scream at people. Real leaders are a part of the team. They view the team as bigger than them. I talk a lot about servant leadership, where, look, titles are temporary. The cemeteries of the world are full of irreplaceable people.
Sure.
None of us are that big a deal. I don't care what your title is. That what you got to do is you got to realize that your job is to build the organization for the long term and to impact the lives of the people that you touch. And if you take that approach, even when people disagree with you, if they know that you're honest, if they know you can be trusted, if they know you have a good soul, then they're going to go with you. And so I've always learned that the one thing that as a leader, a real leader, you can't violate is the trust of your team. You know, look, if you make decisions, people are going to be unhappy. A decision means that you did one thing instead of another, and there's going to be some people who wanted you to do the other. But if they know that in your soul, you're not doing it to make yourself look good. You're trying to make a decision that's going to make the team win. People will follow you.
Absolutely. You and I both know people who think, well, gosh, just because I have the title, people should do what I tell them to do. And, of course, you and I both know that's not how it works. I always tell people the most important thing is if you want to lead, people need to know that you care about them. We need, have to take just a quick commercial break right now, but stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk about more of the leadership practices, the 9 leadership practices in John Addison's new book. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm here today with John Addison, author of the book Real Leadership, and we're talking about what he calls the 9 practices of real leaders. John, you talk a lot about the idea that you need to shine the light on others and give them credit, but yet when things go wrong, you need to say my mea culpa. You need to put that on your shoulders. Talk to us about that for just a bit.
You know, I think most real leaders are the antithesis of politicians. You know, usually a politician, when something's going great, they can, you can, you know, the number of times they say the word I mean, it's I did this, I did that. When things go bad, it's always they, the they out there that did it. It's opposite with great leaders and real leaders. When things go well, it's we. It's team. It's big team, little me. When things are going good, I worked very hard. If you ever heard me speak in front of a big crowd of people, I don't say the word I say we. I worked hard training myself in my mind to insert we instead of I. It's always we. It's always our. It's always together. When things go bad, even when it's not your fault, sometimes people under you make bad decisions or whatever. You got to own it. You're the leader. Hey, when the football team loses, the head coach is responsible. When the economy's crappy, the president's in charge. I mean, great leaders, real leaders, own the problem. And, you know, that's the reason sometimes even when it's not their fault, they have to resign or step down. Look, you know, when you step into the world of leadership, that comes with responsibility. So you don't get to just go, hey, things are great, look at me. Oh, things are bad, look at them. It's really the opposite.
And so people with small businesses that get started that don't understand this, they always think that, well, my employees there are there to serve me. And really the reality of it is a leader knows that he or she is the servant to his or her team. Isn't that correct?
That's absolutely correct. I mean, you know, most of the great leadership lessons you can learn in life, you could read in the Bible. I mean, in truth, I mean, you know, it's about them. It's about the team. It's about your customers. You've got to approach that. When you're in a leadership position, you know, you're responsible. And so I think many of the great leaders, you know, we were talking about shining the light on others. One of the great stories that I remember reading, I read a lot of history. I love to read history. Winston Churchill's one of my, you know, heroes. I'm a member of the Churchill Society. But there's a great story about a lady who was a journalist. And it was when Benjamin Disraeli was running against Gladstone for Prime Minister of England. You know, it was a big election between the parties, and whoever prevailed, either Disraeli or Gladstone, would be the Prime Minister. And she met with Gladstone, and then she met with Disraeli. And she had an interesting comment. She said, "I spent an hour with Mr. Gladstone, and at the end of it, I thought he must be the most brilliant man in England. I spent an hour with Mr. Disraeli, and after it, I thought I must be the most brilliant woman in England." See, he made her feel special. It was about her. Great leaders shine their light on other people. It's not all about me and my ego and how I look. It's about how the team looks. If the team looks good enough, guess what? The light's going to shine back on you plenty. So, you know, you're responsible for others. That's the job of a leader. Mm-hmm. I think too often now, you know, in this kind of narcissistic world we're in now, it's me, 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 I, look at me. The truth is, great leaders are about we, not me.
I agree totally. You know, a lot of our viewers are in positions in corporations where perhaps they don't have direct leadership, or at least they perceive themselves to not having that because they don't have the title per se. And a lot of our viewers are also retired. So can you tell them how they can truly be a leader in their own lives and with the people around them without having a title?
I appreciate that question very much, because I think that's a misnomer to people a lot, is that maybe you don't have the position, maybe you don't have the title. Look, the reality is the greatest leader, the person I learned the most leadership skills from in my life was my mom. She was a school teacher. She didn't have a big job, thousands of people reporting to her, but she was one of the most influential people I've ever known. In our small community in Georgia, she was the center. When somebody was having a marital problem, a family problem, whatever, they always called her Miss Ruth. Everybody would talk to Miss Ruth. I mean, she just made people feel better. She lifted them up. When she passed away suddenly, unfortunately, 10 years ago, she was 80 years old. At her funeral, even though she was 80, the little church was packed. People were outside, people of all ages, kids she taught. She influenced people. And see, leadership is influence. Whether you've got a title or not, you can be a positive force. You can influence people. You can make things better. I became a leader, but way before I had a title. When I was in a meeting, when I was a young man and didn't have the title, I had influence. I could convince other people of what I believed. And so don't wait till you have a title. If you wait till you have a title, it's too late. I mean, you need to build these skills in life before you get there.
Absolutely. So you learned your leadership from the same source, which I did. Yours is Miss Ruth, and mine was my mom, Miss Irene. And I guess that's, for those of us fortunate to have learned it at home, that's awesome. And for those of us who are not fortunate enough to have learned it at home, I really recommend that you pick up John's book. Again, Real Leadership, Nine Practices for Leading and Living with Purpose. So, John, thank you so much for being here today. I really appreciate it, and I really did love your book. I couldn't put it down once I picked it up.
Well, thank you so much. That means the world to me, and you know, I hope people do pick up the book, because I believe leadership is the scarcest resource that we have. And my goal now is to be an evangelist for real leadership.
That's awesome.
Look at me braggadocious.
Good for you.
And I appreciate your time. Thank you so much. I've enjoyed talking to you.
I appreciate your time also. And stay with us, because when we come back after the break, we're going to talk more about leadership and how you can espouse leadership in your own personal financial life. We'll be right back.